This is the Unstarving Musicians Podcast. The podcast features conversation for musicians of all types and genres, a curation of expertise intended to help all musicians be better at marketing, business, the creative process, and all the other things that empower us to do more of what we love, make music. This episode is powered by the Unstarving Musician's Guide to Getting Paid Gigs, How to Get Booked and Paid What You're Worth Over and Over Again, written by Roberto R. Hernandez. That's me, yours truly. Learn more about the book at unstarvingmusician.com/book and on Amazon. In this episode, I chat with rock photographer Neil Zlozower. Neil is considered by many to be one of the best rock photographers of all time, although he refers to himself as merely a fairly successful photographer. He's photographed many greats, including Zeppelin, The Stones, Van Halen, Motley Crue, Sheryl Crow, Guns N' Roses, Eric Clapton, Pantera, and many, many, many more. These days, Neil spends most of his time running Atlas Icons, an agency he co-founded and that specializes in licensing of music photography. You can find his work at Zloz.com, that's Z-L-O-Z.com, and AtlasIcons.com. Neil unintentionally challenged my interviewing skills in this episode. In this podcast, I do my best to ask questions that will help musicians. What we ended up talking about is Neil's career, changes in the music business, and the business of photography, which is fairly normal for the podcast. Did our conversation end up with some gems you can use for your music journey? I think so, but more than that, I found our discussion very interesting and at times entertaining, and I hope you will find it to be the same. I'm going to give you a quick disclaimer, though. Neil is opinionated and at times colorful in his choice of words, to put it mildly. If you're easily offended by language or things otherwise non-PC, this episode may not be for you. Consider yourself forewarned. Please enjoy this fascinating conversation with Neil Zlozower. Neil, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Robonzo. I'm glad you wanted me on the show.
You came highly recommended by our friend Bill Lanero, and I would like to know, I didn't even ask Bill, who was, as you know, featured in an earlier episode, how you guys became acquainted initially. Can you tell me real quick how that happened?
Bill actually contacted me and wanted to do a photo shoot with me, and he lives in San Jose, so he contacted me and drove down, and we attempted to do a photo shoot, but it didn't quite happen that day. I've done quite a few shoots with Bill over the years.
Bill made me aware of your work, obviously, and a few weeks ago when I looked at your website, you have done work with so many artists, most of whom I think I probably can safe to say I grew up with all of them, and if I didn't, it's only because I just wasn't particularly into what they were doing at the time. But, you know, the list is everything from Zeppelin and Van Halen to Michael Jackson and Motley Crue, so it's really cool. I see you've done at least 3 books around your work, which is very cool too.
5 to be exact.
Yeah, I see 3 on your site. I would love to...
Well, yeah, because the other ones are all sold out, so you can't get them anymore. They're sort of difficult to get.
Are there any plans to reissue them, and what were they, since I didn't get to see what they were?
Well, you probably saw Eddie Van Halen, A Visual History, Van Halen, Visual History, and the other one is probably Fuck You, Rock and Roll Portraits. But there was also a Motley Crue Visual History and a book, 6 String Heroes, which is a collection of photographs of a lot of the guitarists that I like and listen to and thought were some of the greatest guitarists that grace this planet. So those are the other 2 that aren't on my site.
Any chance they're going to come back in the future?
No.
Well, I'll have to just try and find them in the historic archives on the Google or something. I'm kind of curious. You've got me curious now.
Yeah, you could get them on Amazon, I think. Maybe not. I don't know. And you could probably go on eBay and find them. But I may have 2 or 3 of the Motley books here and 2 or 3 of the 6 String Heroes. Like I said, they're sort of hard to get.
Yeah, well, that's cool. And you are based in San Jose, right?
No, I'm in Los Angeles.
Ah, okay.
I'm sitting about a block away from Capitol Records right now.
I'll be darned. Wow. Funny thing with Bill Lanero, I was living his neighbor for about 17 years and didn't even know it. So I think I saw him post something on Facebook and reached out to him, found out that he lives in San Jose. I asked the question because I'm going to be visiting soon, and I thought, oh, maybe I can run into you, but probably not, perhaps another time.
Where are you? You're in South America?
In technically Central America. I'm in Panama. My wife and I moved here a little over a year ago, and prior to that, 17 years in San Jose, and I'm originally from Arlington, Texas, the suburb of Dallas-Fort Worth, which you're probably familiar with. But...
Yeah, I was going to say you don't have a Latin accent, so it's pretty American, so I was wondering where you were from.
Well, funny thing is both my parents were Mexican. My mom was born in Texas in a border town. My father was an immigrant from Mexico, but I didn't really speak a heck of a lot of Spanish until we moved here, but that's for another podcast.
What border town? I've been all over Texas before.
Mercedes. It's, I think, close to like Brownsville area and Reynosa on the Mexico side.
Yeah, I've been to Brownsville, but I've been to El Paso. I've been all over Texas. Trust me, I used to love going to Texas.
I bet. All right, so let's get into your work here. It's particularly interesting for me, and I hope we'll talk about this in a little bit, I hope, because most of my interviews have been with indie artists. To this point, many of them coming up, I've had a couple of guys who've been in the business for a long time and have worked with some of the same people you have. In one case, worked with some of the same people you have. But I think there's a large sort of indie artist listenership and sort of the guest roster. So I hope that we can talk a little bit about like things that you might be able to impart upon them from your work history. But how'd you first get into rock photography?
I started off my rock and roll career being a glorified fan. I love music ever since I was a little kid. I used to go to concerts. First concert I ever saw in my life was Cream at the Santa Monica Civic, February 23rd, 1968. And that was a turning point for me. I was probably 13 or 14 years old. And you see one of your idols live, and it was a great moment. And then right around that time, I bought a camera, not really ever planning to be a rock and roll photographer, just bought a camera to shoot pictures, walk down the street, shoot pictures. I was like shooting the old Jewish people on Fairfax who looked like the people that time forgot, and started taking my camera to shows. And back then they didn't have the big bouncers, so I could just walk up to the front basically and shoot photos of my quote unquote idols. And then started developing my own pictures, and I'd hang them on my bedroom wall like all other little 13, 14-year-old kids like to do.
So, interestingly, perhaps, when I was about the same age, maybe when I was more like about 17, I had a camera at the time and was doing the high school photography class thing, you know, learned how to develop. But I started taking cameras to shows, but at that time I had to sneak them in. Was there a time when you were young when you didn't and then you did, or were you already working professionally before that ever became an issue?
No, I mean, you don't just all of a sudden buy a camera and become a professional. You have to hone your trade and craft and learn how to work the controls on the camera. I mean, I was pretty wet under the ears when I first started, but just like anything in life I wanted to do, whether it was cook amazing meals or work on cars or work on motorcycles, if you really have the willpower and drive to do it, especially now with the internet, you could basically do anything you want. If you're going to be a lawyer or a brain surgeon or a doctor, yes, you have to go to school. But I'd say 85% of the things that interest people, whether you want to become an electrician or a plumber, you could go online and just learn to do what you have to do. So it took me, I'd come home and back then I'd look at the photos and thought they were great. I still have all those negatives, and now I look at them going, what the hell was I thinking? These sort of suck. So it was a long haul. But also remember, now in the digital age, everybody with a camera thinks they're a professional photographer. And I lived in a time where, no, you could not look on the back of your camera and go, wow, it's too light, we got to make it darker. Oh, wow, I need a faster shutter speed. You had to know your craft back then because you were shooting film, which was expensive, and to process it was expensive. Now, there's no film and processing, so you could put in a 64-gigabyte card in your camera, you could shoot thousands of photos, and most of the photographers I see, there's no attention to detail anymore. I could be doing a photo shoot, well, not me, let's just say your wife could be doing a photo shoot with you, and behind your head in the background, there's a big tree growing. It looks like it's growing right out of the top of your head. And I'm like, whatever your wife's name is, hey, Mary, don't you see that tree growing out of the top of Rabonzo's head? Oh, Neil, we'll just fix that later in the mix. Well, why don't you just move 5 inches to the left or 5 inches to the right so the big tree isn't growing out of Rabonzo's head? So nowadays, I'm pretty much retired from being a photographer. because I want to go out on top. I don't want to sit there and be like these photographers with Getty Image that are getting 20 cents for their photos and $2 for their photos. I lived in a time when people respected photography, and being a photographer meant something, and it was sort of an honored trade to actually be a professional photographer. It meant something. Now it means nothing. It's one of the most worthless professions in the whole world.
So, speaking of honing your craft, and by the way, I certainly didn't mean to imply that that part didn't take a while. My original question was about, did you ever have a time before you did become a pro where you had to sneak your cameras into concerts?
I've snuck cameras into shows. People like David Bowie, who didn't really give photo passes, and I wanted the photos. So, I had to sneak cameras in and shoot from my seat, or should I say, buy a ticket. I wouldn't shoot from my seat because I usually bought the cheapo seats, and I honed the art / craft of sneaking up towards the stage and always being able to find an empty seat here or an empty seat there, or stoop down in the aisle and shoot. So my seats were usually the cheapo deluxe that I'd buy instead of try to go get the front row seats or anything like that. So the answer to your question is yes.
Yeah, it did. So on honing your skills, did you do any formal education, or was it all kind of on the road in the field education, or a mix of both?
Well, I took photography in high school just because I think in high school, before you graduated, you need either a practical art or a something else art before you could graduate. But it's funny because I think I only turned in like 4 or 6 pictures at the end of the year, but they were technically superior and everything was perfect and they were sharp and the prints were amazing. And then there were the people who turned in 50 prints at the end of the year that were blurry and out of focus and had dust marks and scratches and the prints looked like crap, but they would get an A in the class, and I ended up getting a C in that class, which I thought was pretty funny that here I am, a fairly successful photographer, and I got a C in photography class in high school. So
that's funny. So was the rest of your honing your craft, was that out in the field doing what you did for so many years?
Yeah, basically, like the old term, practice makes perfect. You go out there, and you know, that's what I tell people that really want to learn photography. Don't go out there and put your camera on automatic so the camera does the thinking for you. Put it on manual so you have to set the shutter speeds, you have to set the f-stops, you have to manually focus. I was doing a photo shoot with Sheryl Crow yesterday, and at one point I'm like, Sheryl, look, I don't use this automatic focus and automatic crap, so bear with me because it'll take me a tenth of a second longer than the people that use the automatic functions on their cameras.
That's nice. I haven't had any other than an iPhone, which I realize is for what kind of an amazing camera from when we were kids, but I haven't had a digital camera. My last good cameras were the analog where everything was adjusted. So I didn't know it was very common. I'd never even thought of it that you can still manually adjust them. But I imagine I'll get one of those again.
Yeah, you can. There's a setting you can put the cameras on M for manual. And I set my shutter speeds and I set my f-stops. And I never autofocus. Never, ever, ever. So I like to do the thinking. I don't want the camera to think for me. When people hire me, they want my vision. They don't want the camera's vision. They want me to give them the Zlo's vision and me do the thinking. So
you said you were technically retired, and I assume that was from photography, but you did a shoot yesterday. Are you just kind of doing work by referral or request these days?
Well, listen, when there was film and processing, the clients had to hire people who knew what they were doing, because I would basically charge back $30 for every roll of film processing and the snip processing, where they cut like 6 or 7 frames off the roll and they process that, and the photographer would look at it and go, oh, it's too light, make it darker, it's too dark, make it lighter. But now, like I said, back to the scenario with the 64 gigabyte memory chip, there's no film and processing. So now the clients, if I shot 10 rolls of film before, that would be 360 frames theoretically, and that would be $300 in film and processing, let alone my fee on top of that back in the day. Now, there's no film and processing, so the clients basically will just hire some idiot from the mail room or whatever, and they'll go out, and a photo session nowadays is like, let's say, someone shooting slash. And they'll just be click, 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 click. And the people give no direction to slash. They give no input. They don't say anything. And they shoot 10,000 photos, and three of them are maybe good enough. And then they give it to the art director, who spends 3 days in Photoshop fixing the triple chins and the trees coming out of the head in the background and every other flaw that the photographer has in the photos, because they don't pay any attention to detail. But the client basically got it for $100 or $200. The photographers in this day and age, I have a friend of mine, he's probably the greatest living live rock photographer on the planet, in my eyes. His name's Igor Vidyashev. He lives in Toronto. To me, he's the greatest living live rock photographer. He should be working with Madonna and the Stones and Bruce Springsteen and Taylor Swift. The guy's hurting to make a living, and he's number one in my eyes. If you put me in the photo pit next to him, my photos would be 30% as good as Igor's. The guy's just out of control, amazing.
I'll have to look him up.
His website is Rock Exposure with an X, so ROCKXPOSURE. His photos are phenomenal. Just, I can't say it. So Igor basically made me retire from shooting live shows, because I want to go out on top being number one, and if I can't, then I don't want to do it anymore. So you'll never see me at a concert shooting live photos. I still do sessions.
Oh, I was going to say, how did he make you retire? Are you saying that because of the work he does? Or?
Well, because he's a friend, because he's better than me.
Oh.
So I want to be number one, and if I feel there's people better than me, why do I want to do it when there's someone better than me? And he's a friend of mine, so I send all the work that people want me to do live, I send it to him. He's in Toronto, so he just shot Zach Sabbath last night. I hooked him up with Zach Wilde, who's like my little baby brother. I've known Zach since about 87, and I set him up with all my bands that I used to work with, no matter who it is. And I just say, use this guy. He's the best. Don't use me, because this guy's much better than me when it comes to live photos.
He's got some amazing work.
I did do some amazing work, but I don't have that enthusiasm anymore to shoot live stuff. Like yesterday with Sheryl, she was amazing. One of the nicest people I ever worked with. Total professional. We got along great, and I had fun. But I don't want to drive to the Forum, pay $25 for parking, have to go meet 15 other photographers who don't know what they're doing, so the publicist could walk us down to shoot three songs of some band at the Forum, and then we have to leave. Okay, that's not what I used to do. If I'm going to shoot a live show, it's going to be for someone I know. They're going to give me the whole show. I can go on stage. I can go in front of the stage. I can do whatever I want. But I don't even want to do that anymore. It just doesn't interest me anymore. I've moved on to other areas.
What is interesting you today?
Photography-wise, I do sessions for my clients who know what I do. I do a lot of stuff for Guitar Player, Bass Player, Drum Magazine. I have a few clients that still hire me to do advertising stuff for their companies, but I don't actively go out and try to solicit myself. Like in Anaheim every year, there's something called the NAMM Show,
mm-hmm.
National Association of Music Merchants. And every company in the world, Gibson, Fender, Pearl Drums, Vader Drumsticks, Sabian Cymbal, every guitar company, ESP, Schecter, they're all there. 15, 20 years ago, I'd walk around, and the thing's about five football fields. So 20 years ago, I used to go, hey, Joe, how's it going, man? I haven't seen you. We haven't done anything together. Who's coming into town? Let's do some work together. You know, really like to shoot something for you. I don't want to do that. I don't go and sell myself or try to solicit work anymore. I just don't need to. I've moved on to other areas that I do things with.
Are the other areas that you're pursuing right now, are they photography related, or are they outside of photography?
Actually, in 2011, myself and a fellow photographer friend, Eddie Malouk, who's a New York photographer, he came up with a brilliant idea to start a photo agency, because people need stuff right now. I used to basically, if someone wanted a photo from me, I'd say, make a list, like the magazines, and they'd give you a list with Steve Vai, Billy Sheehan, Van Halen, Led Zeppelin, whatever. Then you'd get the list, you know, and you'd usually take it on the phone. And then a few days later, you'd go down and pull out slides, and then you'd make a FedEx package and FedEx the original irreplaceable slides to the magazine. And then they would take a couple weeks to make their layout and take your slides to the separator and so on. Now, people call you at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and they need the image by 2 because they're going to press at 5 o'clock. So Eddie came up with the brilliant idea, like, hey, Neil, why don't we start a photo agency together? And I'm like, Eddie, I'm just a scummy little photographer. I'm not the owner of a photo agency. And besides, you're already in an agency with George Chin, who's a fellow photographer friend of ours. He's like, Neil, I'd leave George in a second to start a photo agency with you. So we toyed with the idea, and we basically started a photo agency called Atlas, AtlasIcons.com. And there, you can go on to atlasicons.com and look through thousands of Van Halen photos or Led Zeppelin or Taylor Swift. Or we sell a lot of different photographers who we consider some of the best photographers in the world, new and old. And we license their photos to TV shows, magazines, billboards, whatever. It's all over the world, Australia, Mexico, UK, Italy, Australia, so on. So that's one of the things I do now. Like I told you before the podcast started, I'm right now, as we speak, scanning photos of Ritchie Blackmore's Rainbow from 1976 and Fleetwood Mac from 1976. So my days involve me loading the scanner, scanning stuff, and then I go home at night. And since my stuff's been handled so much by different people, art directors, publicists, I have to go in every single shot of mine, at least, that's on Atlas Icons, has been opened up, dust marks removed, scratches removed, images lightened, images darkened, contrast raised, contrast lowered. So if I have 300,000 images on Atlas Icons, every single one of those 300,000 images has been opened up and worked on to make them look as perfect as possible.
Cool. It sounds like you're having fun doing this.
I enjoy it. I sort of sometimes feel like a plastic surgeon fixing things and so on. But another thing, which is literally my favorite thing to do now, is I basically scour the internet and looking for infringers who illegally use my photos. And I'm a big stickler on copyright and an advocate of photographers' rights. I mean, we get screwed all the time. If I want to make money in this day and age, instead of shooting photos, all I have to do is type in Van Halen, Motley Crue, Guns N' Roses, Led Zeppelin, Zakk Wylde, whoever. I do a Google image search. Thousands of my photos are all over the internet used without my permission, and I just send the links right to my lawyer, and we settle out of court for ridiculous money.
That's great.
Oh, yeah. At any given time, like right this second, I probably have 30 to 40 different infringements. I can't go after the people who put my stuff on Pinterest and Instagram and all those stupid sites. But if my stuff is on any site where there's advertising or anything, we go after them, and I have no mercy for them.
Interesting. And that's actually fun, huh?
I like it because we just settled a case for a company. I won't say who. But they used one photo of mine of Zakk Wylde on their website. We settled that one out of court for $21,000. Now, if they came to me and said, Neil, we want to use this shot of Zakk on our website, how much would you charge us? I would have been lucky to get $200 or $300 for it. So we settled out of court for $21,000. Out of that $21,000, I don't get the whole thing. I'll probably see about $9,100. So I basically settled it for 5,000% more than I would have got if they came to me and asked permission to use it and said they'll pay me a fee. So, yes.
You welcome the infringement then.
I welcome it. Like, there's a couple Van Halen sites and they constantly rip my photos off. And I spoke to my lawyer. I'm like, Richard, can't you go after these assholes that just use my photos illegally? He's like, look, Neil, these people probably don't have any money. They're little pieces of shit scum. He goes, but that's not to say that someone with money won't end up going to their site, seeing this photo of Eddie Van Halen, and saying, oh, well, let's just right-click and use it on our site in an Eddie Van Halen story. I'm a Buddhist. One thing I learned, you have to open up your eyes and look at every situation from a lot of different angles. Most people look at something from just one angle, and they only see one aspect. But if you look hard enough, no matter how bad something seems, you can always find something good, whether someone dies, someone gets an illness, whatever. You break up with your wife or your husband or your boyfriend or your girlfriend. If you really look at any given situation from enough different angles and really try hard, you can usually find at least one good thing that comes out of every bad situation.
Sure. Was there someone that was like, wow, it struck you as, wow, I'm making it or I've made it, and or doing work with that person really sort of helped develop a new level of credibility in the business?
Well, if you talk to basically anybody who's followed my career or followed my photographs or who has known about me, basically 90-95% of all those people would probably say, yeah, I was latching up with Van Halen in 1978, because I think that's what I really became known as, Van Halen's photographer. But I was doing a lot of work with Black Oak Arkansas, who, believe it or not, was a huge band in the early 70s. And I did a lot of shooting with Led Zeppelin. And I was basically had a photo of the Rolling Stones, me and my partner back in the early 70s. We had a photo in Life magazine from the 72 tour where they hired my idol and the greatest living rock photographer in the world, and maybe even one of the greatest living photographers, Jim Marshall, who was my idol, who's sadly no longer with us, but he was hired by Life magazine to do the 1972 Stones tour. He had all the photos except one photo me and my partner had in Life magazine. So I worked with a lot of big name bands before Van Halen. It just seems like everybody seems to think Van Halen really put me on the map, because I started with them when they were pretty much nobodies. And one of my philosophies about being a great rock and roll photographer is trying to pick out what bands you think are going to make it big before they make it big. Because once they make it big, all the parasite, maggot, sponge, leech photographers come out of the woodwork and want to work with you. But when the bands aren't big, no one either knows about you or no one wants to work with you because you aren't big and the magazines aren't running you and your records really aren't selling and no one knows about you. So I picked out Black Oak Arkansas. I picked out Ted Nugent. I picked out Aerosmith, Van Halen. I picked out Quiet Riot, Poison, Rat, Guns N' Roses, Motley Crue. I picked out all those bands when I first heard their music and said, these guys are going to be big. I want to work with them. And I did, when they were basically not too far along in their careers. And when they rose to the top, I rose to the top with them.
Was the Van Halen gig like your first kind of like you were the staff photographer or the band photographer, the official one guy?
No, not really. I mean, you know, it's really stupid for a band to just work with one photographer. I don't know what goes on in this day and age. Usually, probably now, a person like Taylor Swift or whoever is going to have one photographer, and he's got basically in front of the stage access and could do whatever he wants. And she may let other photographers into the shows, but they probably have to shoot from the soundboard with a 400 millimeter lens. I would never even go to a show where I had to shoot from a soundboard with a 400 millimeter lens. It's not worth the effort for me. So back then, I was basically, put it this way, we're all the same age, me and the Van Halen guys and me and the Motley guys and Poison and Rat and Guns N' Roses. So I was like their friend slash comrade. I was their buddy. It just happened to be I was also a photographer, but I was sort of cooler than most of the other photographers. So I could infiltrate with them. I could hang with them. I could go to parties with them. I could drink with them. I could do drugs with them, whatever. They felt like I was part of their family, not he's a photographer. Most photographers I know are, I probably wouldn't even want to hang with most of them. to be honest with you, because most photographers I know are sort of retarded idiots. But I know them all, and there's some I like better than others. But I always got along good with the people in the bands back then. We were all young. We all liked girls. We all liked drinking. We liked to have a good time, so on and so forth.
Yeah, as you were rattling some of those off, I assumed that you were in the same area as, I guess, several of them anyway. The business of photography, much less the music business, has changed a lot since you first started in it, to put it mildly. But do you watch many indie artists these days and see mistakes that they make in terms of what they do or don't invest in photography? And I had a recent guest who's based in Nashville. She's a young, up-and-coming hopeful, very talented. She had a, for me, as someone who does a podcast like this and tries to promote the shows and co-market them with my guests, she was a dream in one regard, in that she had a lot of great photography available, where some of my guests, some of whom have been in the business forever, had somewhat to very limited number of shots available for me to use. And then some others have almost nothing. So do you pay much attention to what the newer artists are or are not doing? And if so, do you have any recommendations or advice for them?
Well, two things. When you say artists, do you mean photographers or do you mean musician artists?
Music artists.
No, I don't pay attention to any. I live in Los Angeles. There's really no radio stations here. When I'm driving in my car, I listen to AM news. You know you're getting old when you listen to AM news. But no, there's no way for me to really be exposed to any new type of music. I mean, the music industry is in a total disarray. It's just a shell of what it used to be at one time. I don't even know if people make CDs anymore. I don't know if there's any record companies that promote anything. So basically, you could probably name 20 of the newest, hottest bands that are out there. I probably never heard of any of them, to be honest with you.
What about with photographers?
You know, I get magazines every month and I'm like, oh, who shot this picture? And it'll be a name I never heard of. But I know photographers who've been photographers for a long time and probably some of the biggest photographers in the world, but you could get these new photographers and maybe Getty sells a photo here or Shutterstock sells a photo there, but there's no name that comes to my mind that I see constantly over and over and over and over that, what do you call it, really tickle my fancy. I mean, most of the shots I see now, like I just got the new Guitar Player magazine, I thumbed through it, and every single photo is a different person that I never heard of before. The problem is, like I told you earlier, being a photographer in this day and age means absolutely nothing, and it's probably the most worthless profession anybody could want to do to make money. Okay, if you want to be a photographer just to shoot pictures, that's one thing. But if you're trying to make a living at it like I do and used to do, it's just not going to happen. It's almost impossible.
Let me back into the same question a different way. When the business was what it was when it was good, in the part of your career where you were doing what you would consider your own best work, did you work with artists from time to time? Maybe you watched some of the artists that you did or did not work with eventually. Were there things that you observed them doing that, given the opportunity, you might have pulled them aside and said, hey, you might want to think about this or that? And I'm talking, of course, in terms of how they ultimately were represented photographically.
I'm always giving people input, like, don't wear this clothes or your hair looks like shit or whatever. I mean, I remember, not photographically, I remember Quiet Riot was opening up for Loverboy. It was like 1981, 82, and they were all whining and complaining, dude, we aren't getting anywhere, or just, I don't know what's going on. I'm like, guys, you guys are killing it every night. Just keep on opening up for Loverboy. Be exposed to the 3,000 or 4,000 people that are watching you every night, and you can work hard and you'll become a success. And next thing you know, their first album, I think, was one of the biggest selling albums after Peter Frampton Comes Alive. So I got a big mouth. When it comes to photography, if someone's posing wrong or doing something that I don't think looks good, I'll tell them, yeah, don't do that, do this, or do this with your body or whatever. I'm not afraid to speak my mind, as you could probably tell while you're talking to me. So anyway, that's basically.
Sure. Did you work with clients who maybe you're oversensitive to your opinions or recommendations from time to time, or could you sense those kind of people easily that, like, I'm not sure we can work, you're going to enjoy working with me or whatever? Or
it's funny because right now this Irish film documentary person is doing a documentary on me, and Scott Ian from Anthrax is interviewed. He's like, look, if you're thin-skinned, don't work with Zlozower because you might not like what comes out of his mouth, okay? So I remember in 1980 I shot, let's just say, I'm not going to mention the name, but the two main people in the band are two girls, and there were three guys in the band. And I was shooting them, and it was a big shoot. And after about two rolls of film, the right-hand man of the band, who later went on to become Pearl Jam's manager, said, hey, Neil, how much more? Are you almost done? I'm like, almost done? We only shot two rolls of black and white. I didn't even shoot any color or individual. He goes, make this the last roll, because so-and-so can't really deal with you telling her to do this and telling her to do that and so on. So just make this the last roll. I'm like, okay, fine. So there's been a couple times where maybe I'm a little too honest with people for them to really not like hearing what I say, but it's only for them to look better in the final photo. Like I said, the new photographers will just get someone up there and they'll just start shooting, and there's no interaction between the photographer and the subject, and there's no direction or anything. Like Sheryl said yesterday, she goes, I really like when you tell me lift your chin, tilt your head this way, stick your chin out, do this, do that, because I know it's only going to help me in the photos look better. But some people just are too high on the hog or too full of themselves and don't want to hear, oh, you got double chin, so stick your chin out and we'll just give you one chin instead of two, or you look fat, so move your body like this so you don't look fat or whatever. Yeah. So I want to get the very best possible shot, and I don't want the people to just stand there looking like, I wonder what I'm going to eat for dinner. I wonder what's on TV tonight. I wonder what my wife's cooking me. I'm trying to get a sense in their mind of what they're doing. I mean, in the 1980s, when I shot all the hair bands, I'd have a speech that before, I don't just get up on the backdrop and start shooting. I go, okay, look, guys, your record just went double platinum. You're playing two sold-out shows at the Forum tonight. Give me some rock star attitude. And then they'd get up there and they'd do their rock star poses, and you could see mentally in their face they were into it. I mean, I've shot pictures of bands where, let's say, three or four of the guys look good and one guy's not so good looking and one guy's horrendous looking. But I've come to realize it doesn't matter how good or bad someone thinks you look when they're talking to you in real life. It's all the attitude that you have in your mind. So, for instance, I shot this band once and five guys, and the drummer was a really good looking guy in the band. But he just, when I got up and shot him, he just had this look like, and then the bad looking guys in the band were, yeah, we don't need this fucking photo shit. We're rock stars. Fuck this crap. And they'd get up there and give me these looks that he just had the most killer attitude, and they would look phenomenal, where the good looking guy just had no attitude or nothing at all, but he looked great in person, and he just didn't come across like with any vibe or anything like that. So I try to give them a little pep talk, people, before I shoot them. I mean, I used to. Now I don't do that so much because there's no rock hair bands anymore, to be honest with you.
Yeah. When did the business change from a point where you were like, okay, I'm kind of out now? Did that happen in the 2000s, or was it already going on in the 90s? Or
in the 90s, everything changed. First of all, there's been a couple changes. The first change was when Guns N' Roses and Metallica broke on the scene. So before Guns N' Roses, everybody hired clothing designers to make their clothes and stylists, and everybody had the hairspray and the poofed hair. Once Guns N' Roses broke in 87, that all changed. The street look was in, all the poofed hairspray was gone, people didn't need to hire clothing designers anymore. So it was a new day and age. It was pre-Guns and post-Guns. But then the next big change came when grunge came in the 90s. And that was a really sad period, because before that, there were probably about 50 American-only rock mags. So if you did a shoot with Bon Jovi, or you did a session with Motley or Poison, you could sell those photos to all the 50 different rock mags. I mean, the money was rolling in those years. It was the Reagan years. Then when Nirvana, Soundgarden, Alice in Chains, Pearl Jam came, it wasn't cool to be rock stars anymore. So the bands didn't want to do photo shoots. And if you did photo shoots with the bands back then, whereas all the bands earlier liked to pose and look right in the lens, the bands like Nirvana, which, by the way, was the worst photo session I ever did in my whole entire life, they would just be there talking to each other and ignore you. They wouldn't look in the lens. It was like the photographer wasn't there and they were just going to do whatever they want. So next thing you know, it went from about 50 American rock magazines down to about 5. Wow. And the photos all look like crap. And the girls in those years, when the chicks all dressed up, they had short skirts, they had spandex pants, seam stockings and everything. They were out to get killed and get laid that night. Then in the 90s, when it was Nirvana and grunge, the girls were like, okay, let's see how ugly I can make myself look. Let's go to the market and see if I can get a potato sack to wear for a dress. So the 90s were just pathetic, okay? And all the magazines folded. All the photographers were singing the blues. But one thing I've been good at during my career was being able to reinvent myself when I needed to. So I just reinvented myself in the 90s, and instead of shooting all these bands on spec like Bullet Boys and Britney Fox and Motley and stuff, I started working with all the equipment manufacturers, Pearl drums, Gibson guitars, Fender guitars, you know, Vader drumsticks, Sabian cymbals, so on and so forth. So instead of shooting all these bands on spec and paying an assistant to come into my studio and help me, I did work for all the companies I just mentioned, and those were all paid jobs. And that worked out great. For the next 20 years, that was a big part of my income. I'm like, I don't want to shoot these bands on spec that maybe I do a photo shoot and a week later, they kick out the drummer and get a new drummer. Well, the photo shoot you did a week earlier, might as well throw it in the trash because all the magazines want to get the most current shots that they can get. They don't want shots with the old drummer. They want shots with the new drummer. So I didn't have to worry about that anymore. And most of the shoots I did for the equipment manufacturers only entailed shooting one person, which is a lot easier than shooting 4 or 5 people.
What gave you the idea in this particular period to reinvent yourself, to do work with the manufacturers? What inspired you to do that? What made you realize that was the way to go?
Well, I mean, that's just me being me. You know, I like to think that I'm sort of a genii, which is many geniuses put together. So it's like when my business starts faltering and I got bills to pay and I can't pay my bills anymore, I'd say it's time to put on the thinking cap and reinvent your business. So I'm a survival guy. I don't just sit here and twiddle my thumbs if the phones aren't ringing. I get on the phone and hustle. The biggest problem with most photographers I know, they could be the greatest photographer in the world. But like I tell people, only 30% of being a photographer is actually shooting the photos. The most important part is being a great business person. It's a proven fact that with actors or athletes or any successful people, it's not necessarily because of their talents or their skill, but more because of the drive they have to succeed. And I always, in my mind, wanted to be, in my mind, the greatest rock and roll photographer on the planet. And there was a magazine called Cream back in the 80s, and every year they used to have a reader's poll. Best band, best album, best producer, best live band, best writer, best photographer. It was about 30 or 40 different categories. And I remember one year I won the best photographer. And to me, that was, okay, I fulfilled that goal / ambition in life because I got voted the best photographer by Cream Magazine, even though it really didn't mean anything in, now in hindsight that I look back. But whether I'm doing a shoot for a friend of mine for free, or whether I'm doing a shoot for $25,000, I try to give it the same amount of attention / care / detail, whether it's a freebie or it's a $25,000 photo shoot.
Interesting. I remember Cream Magazine. I think that's a cool honor. I understand why you would say it really doesn't mean anything, but I think that's pretty cool.
It was back then. It meant something back then.
Yeah, absolutely. I wanted to ask you about Daryl Abbott or Dimebag from Pantera. I saw that you did some work with him. I went to school with three of the guys, and Daryl included, and just kind of curious about how your work with those guys came about and what any memories you might have to share about the work that you did with them.
I worked with Pantera, and they were a tough bunch of guys. I mean, I told you, I love Texas. Dime and his brother Vinny from Texas. And they were good old Texas boys, and they're tough. And obviously, Phil was pretty tough to deal with back then, who's now a sweetheart angel. I haven't seen Phil for a while, but I always get along with him great. He's funny. He always liked me. I make him laugh. But Dime was great. Vinny's great. And the shots you're probably looking at are the ones on the white backdrop. He came in there one day. He was in L.A. for something. He came into my studio, and we had a great shoot. Those are some pretty iconic Dimebag shots, if you ask me. But he was great. I always had a good time. I just shot Rex's last album package. All the new photos you see of Rex are mine. Rex is great. I mean, we're all older. You know, when you're young and dumb. You think you're high on the hog. My kid's 21. He thinks he knows everything. I got to keep him in line and so on and so forth. But, you know, now that we're older, we're all a little more mellowed out, like a fine wine or whatever. So, you know, I get along with anybody. When you have to deal with someone like David Lee Roth or Paul Stanley or Eddie Van Halen or whoever it is, Axl Rose, you got to be able to adapt to the situation. So I may act one way with Paul Stanley, and I may act another way with David Lee Roth or whatever. I get along great with everybody. There's very few people that I basically don't want to ever work with again or just rub me the wrong way or whatever.
Sure. By the way, I have seen your work. I didn't realize that was you that did this stuff for Rex. I talked to Rex occasionally. He and I were, of the three of us that went to school together, he and I are the ones who've stayed in touch most. But anyway, nice work. And I've actually enjoyed those photos a lot.
Okay, good. Well, my friend, as a matter of fact, Igor, sort of tweaked a few of the photos. I mean, another problem in this day and age of being a photographer, everybody goes to Lightroom and they tweak their photos, which is a great way to make a shitty photo look good.
Yeah.
I mean, back when I was shooting film, we had tricks like solarization and bar relief and things like that, which was a great way to make a shitty photo look good. I didn't really like using tricks. I tried to just shoot great photos myself, but Rex called me up and he wanted a little edgier look, so we made it a little gritty and a little grainy, and we turned a lot of the color into black and white, and it just, I can't say enough about Igor's talent as a photographer, and he's a great friend of mine. He's actually coming into town Monday from Toronto to do a shoot, and he'll be staying at my place with me. So.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, he's definitely got some great work. I didn't know, of course, know who he was, but thanks for pointing me to his site. It's very cool.
Yeah, check his website. If you go to rockexposure.com, and you first thing you go, there's a little slideshow of his work. And just, I mean, I look at it and go, I can't do that.
Have you had an opportunity to see musicians, some of the same guys you worked with, reinvent themselves with the changing business as you have in photography and in your world?
Well, I won't say. I mean, if you're talking about a person like Joe Satriani or Steve Vai or whoever, most musicians, the problem is, I was just talking to someone about it yesterday. It's like, let's take Warrant. They come out with the Down Boys album, and then I can't remember the second or third was Cherry Pie, but they were at the height of their career, and then all of a sudden they changed their image and got black leather coats and leather pants, and the music was a little tougher. And all of a sudden, that album didn't do very good because they lost their fan base at, like, the Cherry Pie stuff. So when you're a musician, you don't want to do the same stuff over and over again. But the fans get older, and they sort of can lose track of you. And the musicians want to keep on, I won't say inventing, but they want to try. They don't want to do the same music. They try to go different routes, and it usually doesn't work, to be honest with you. I listen mostly to the same old stuff I've always listened to. I mean, my favorite band in the world right now, as far as new bands, is a band called Rival Sons, who I just think are absolutely phenomenal. I mean, the lead singer Jay's voice is incredible, and Scott Holliday is probably my favorite guitarist out there. But I told you, I'm really not exposed to new music. And Rival Sons, I wouldn't call new, but to me, they're new compared to Led Zeppelin or the Rolling Stones or AC/DC, Bon Scott, or whoever it is. So I'm not really exposed to a lot of new stuff out there.
I love Rival Sons. I got turned on to them listening to the Modern Drummer podcast. Mike Dawson, I guess, yeah, had them featured.
Mike Mealy's the drummer there, but he's great too. The whole band's phenomenal, but the singer, oh my God, Jay, he's just out of control. And Scott's just, you got people like Yngwie and Paul Gilbert, who are all friends of mine, and they play fast, but Scott Holiday is just such a feeling player like Slash. Like Slash could play the same song seven nights a week live, and every night he's going to play it slightly different depending how he's feeling. Whereas you go see some bands and they could play the same song just note for note 7 days a week, and in this part of the song the guy's going to jump up in the air and do split his legs. And you know, they're great players, but there's no feeling. To me, Scott Holiday's just got the greatest feeling out of any guitar player out there right now, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, great band. Of course, when I discovered them and through the channel that I did, the drummer was the guy they were talking about, and he's actually quite phenomenal as well, but good band.
Yeah, he's great. Great. Love that band, Rival Sons. Love it. So
cool. I'm glad to hear it. Well, Neil, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it. It's been interesting. Really admire your work. Thank you for turning me on to some of the other things, your other photographer friend. This will be cool. It was a great pleasure talking with you.
Okay, sounds great. Thank you. Appreciate you having me on your podcast, Rabonzo.
Hey, this is Rabonzo. Thanks so much for listening. If you enjoyed this podcast, please subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, or Google Play Music. If you liked this podcast, please leave a review. This episode was sponsored by the Unstarving Musician's Guide to Getting Paid Gigs, How to Get Booked and Paid What You're Worth Over and Over Again, available on Amazon and in audio format as the Unstarving Musician's Guide podcast. You can also learn more about the book and companion podcast at unstarvingmusician.com/book. Are you a gigging musician, recording artist, songwriter, or touring professional, perhaps struggling to get your music out to the world? Struggling to get the gigs you want? Pop over to unstarvingmusician.com and sign up for my email list. I'll send you occasional emails about upcoming episodes, expert tips and advice, music musician resources, and anything else I come across that might make your journey better and brighter. The Unstarving Musicians podcast is edited by Juan Perez. Are you a podcaster? Would you like 20% off on editing of your first four episodes? Visit the show notes for this episode for a link to Juan's freelance profile or unstarvingmusician.com/resources and mention you heard about this offer through the Unstarving Musicians podcast. With much gratitude, peace, love, and more cowbell.